Good morning. My name is Romain Meuse. I'm from the Vrije Universiteit in Brussels, Belgium. And traditionally, I chair the exchange lecture between the American College of Sports Medicine and the European College of Sports Science. I was a member of the board of both organizations, and one of the tasks I thought when that was the case is to bring these organizations together and have an interaction. And from both sides, there was immediately agreement to do this. Together with Carl Foster from ACSM, we always try to make a program which could be interesting for the broad audience that is at both conferences. And we rotate from basic science over more a medical aspect to the applied science. And this year we're at the medical aspect, and we thought it would be good to look at the heart and the marathon. We have two excellent speakers, but I have to announce that Dr. Keith Short couldn't be here, and therefore Alan Dawson from Liverpool, John Morse will be here to replace him. The second speaker is Bill Roberts, and he is the well-known at ACSM site. He's legendary in the ACSM board meetings, as I can say. But he is from Minneapolis, USA, from the University of Minnesota, and he's the medical director of the Twin Cities Marathon. We'll have the two speakers, one after the other, and we prefer to have a general discussion on the both topics at the end of the talks. So, can I ask you on stage, please?
Right, thanks very much. So, this is obviously the crossover talk between the ACSM and the ECSS. Originally, this talk was given by Professor Greg Whyte in America, but Greg's off being a celebrity sports scientist and doing some filming, so he asked Keith George to stand in. Unfortunately, a couple of days ago, Keith George took ill. So unfortunately, you've got the understudy's understudy today, which is me. So my name's Ellen Dawson. I also work at Liverpool John Moores with Keith and Greg. I actually did my PhD with those two as my supervisors in cardiac fatigue about 12 years ago. However, since then, I've become a vascular physiologist. So Greg sent me his slides yesterday, and I've had an interesting 24 hours trying to catch up on the last 10 years worth of cardiac fatigue. But hopefully what I'll be able to do is give you the general overview and the messages that they were going to be trying to get across in this talk today. So this is some pictures that Greg likes to start his talks with, just to talk about the kind of research that we're going to be discussing here. This is extreme physiology that we're talking about, extreme races. This is not your general jog around the park. We're talking about ultra-endurance events, so marathons and above. And this is just to demonstrate the kind of things that these guys will do to their bodies. They're crazy, they push themselves. I think these two athletes went to the point of getting ischemic bowel syndrome. They ran so much that they made themselves ill that they have to have surgery and eventually kind of ruin their running careers. And Greg put this one in because this is Greg. He's also one of these crazy runners, and he's just completed the Marathon du Sable. So a lot of the data that I'm going to be talking about today is not regular endurance exercise, it's ultra-endurance exercise. So we're going to start with a bit of a history. And fittingly enough, let's go back about 50 years to Salting and Stenberg. This is in like 64. This is, I guess, the origins of this cardiac fatigue. So what they did is they measured cardiovascular function over 5 hours. And if you look at the bottom one, we can see this, we can see this drop in stroke volume on the bottom. But what they found is that blood volume is unchanged up here. I keep hitting the wrong button. So blood volume is unchanged. So they suggested there's something intrinsically happening to the heart that's reducing its function. They called it a drop in the muscle pump function. So the heart is becoming less efficient. They kind of call it fatigued a little bit. It's suddenly becoming not performing to the standard that you would expect. So this is the early evidence of some functional changes in the heart with very prolonged exercise. And then what about some of these biomarkers that we look at? So this is creatine kinase after a marathon. And what they found is that post-marathon, this marker, which is normally taken as evidence of something, some damage to the myocytes, so you would expect this to be elevated with a heart attack, this is up following a marathon. So this is the first full study that looked at these biomarkers of myocardial damage. So we've got some evidence of fatigue from a functional point of view. We've got some evidence of myocardial damage. But what does that mean? So this is some clinical evidence. So this is from McKenchy in the 70s. And this is an x-ray of a couple of guys who'd run, I think it was the Comrades Marathon or certainly an ultra endurance marathon. And I don't know if you can see here on these x-rays, we have some evidence of pulmonary edema. And same from the ECG, we have evidence of pulmonary edema. So we've had the functional changes, we've had biomarker changes, and now it looks like we've got some clinical evidence of something happening. And the interesting thing about this, if something is happening to the lungs, it's suggested maybe something's happening to the right side of the heart. So I'll touch on that a little bit more later on. So that's kind of the background that we have this precedence of something happening to the heart, some downregulation after very prolonged exercise. So this is kind of maybe a hypothesis of what happens. We know that your incidence of a cardiac event drops as you increase your exercise volume, but we might get to a point somewhere where this stops working so well, some cutoff, where all of a sudden that increase in volume stops being beneficial and starts becoming negative. The truth is we don't really know what happens around here because we're lacking in some of the data, we're lacking in the numbers in terms of populations, but it's one hypothesis. Is that there's a certain level of volume which is beneficial. If you go past that, maybe we start doing negative things to the heart. So this is how I'm going to structure this talk. This is from Keith. We're basically going to have a look at some of the cardiac function data, the left and the right side of the heart. We're going to look at some of these markers of cardiac damage. I'm going to touch a very little bit on the conductance side of the heart, so the ECG data. Briefly talk about maybe is this a risk? To us, are we potentially putting ourselves in an adverse position where we're going to have an acute event? And then the long-term effects of cardiovascular. So if you are regularly doing these kind of distances in running and cycling and swimming, are we going to have some long-term effects on the heart that may be beneficial, but also may be negative? So we're going to start off with the cardiac function. So this is just to show you how most of this data was collected. A lot of it's from, say, for example, the Western states. I think Keith's very clever here. He managed to get some field studies in California. I think when I was doing my PhD with him, the furthest we got was Scotland. So they've certainly got something right there. So it's basically to show you, though, that this is field data. So it comes with all the positives and the negatives with field data. We can't control a lot of things, but what we are getting is real-life situations. So this is Dave Oxburgh here and here. Going to present an awful lot of his work. He's a clinical cardiac sonographer, one of the best cardiac sonographers, and he collects some amazing data. But you can see how difficult it can be. Here he is trying to scan underneath a fleece so he can see the screen. And you have to make do with what you can use with this stuff. And this is Rachel Lord, who's just done her PhD with Dave and Keith. I'm going to be presenting some of her data later as well. So this is, I think, the first Western States data. I've just used this as an example. There's lots of data on prolonged exercise now and how it changes. There's meta-analyses and reviews. But basically, if we go back to the sort of the traditional cardiac data, then here what you can see is the responses to exercise. As you expect, heart rate's raised, you get some post-exercise hypotension. But then if we look at these markers of systolic and diastolic function, most of these are reduced, so stroke volume has dropped, ejection fraction and fractional shortening are decreased. Likewise, filling to the heart, so the diastolic function is also dropped post-race. So basically, we've seen it in both left ventricular systolic and diastolic function. And if we move now on to the more novel data on the right here, so this is strain from tissue Doppler and also from myocardial speckle tracking, what we see here is that the longitudinal data has decreased, and so is the circumferential and radial. So basically, what that does is that's tracking the myocardial wall itself, so some more accurate measurements of the contractility of the heart. And basically, it's saying that these are reduced, so we're getting changes in the function of the heart on multiple planes, its ability to shorten and to contract. So here's our evidence of cardiac fatigue. So what does that look like? Thankfully, they worked. So this is at the left ventricle, obviously. Here's the mitral valves. And this is what it looks pre-race. You get this nice, even contraction around the entire wall. And this is what it looks post-race. So this is in one guy after the Comrades Marathon. And what you can see is we've got sections of hyperkinetic sections where they're not moving the way that they should be. And that's quite interesting because if this fatigue in the left ventricle was just due to loading of the left ventricle, so a change in the preload or the change in the afterload, you would expect to see changes across the entire wall. But what we're doing is we've seen it mainly in the septum. So the link between the left and the right side of the heart, which suggests maybe something's happening in the right side of the heart, which is impacting the left side of the heart. So we then see what that looks like a little bit more. So this is just again from the left and this is the left ventricle. So here we can see pre-race, and here you can see a really flattened septum in the left ventricle following the race. So obviously then that brings the question, what's happening to the right side of the heart? So let's have a look at this. So this is, I think, 16 runners from the Western States. And here we can see we have right ventricular function. So the right ventricle is something that's become a bit more popular recently because our techniques have improved and we're able to image it a little bit better. But basically what you can see is it's dilated. So the diastolic area has got bigger. The inflow and the outflow too has got it, and the fractional shortening has dropped. So we have a graphical representation of what's happening there. So here we can see the black line is pre-race and the dotted line is post-race. So this is the ability of the heart to shorten and to contract. And what's happening is it's shortening less and it's delayed post-systolic. So these are two indices that suggest the right ventricular is becoming dysfunctional following this ultra-endurance event. So we're seeing left ventricular dysfunction and right ventricular dysfunction. So I'm just going to do some really brief data on this brand new technique that's coming out from our lab that Dave Oxborough is doing, and Rachel Lord presented this a couple of days ago as part of the YIA. So what they're trying to do is get a non-invasive measurement that's akin to a pressure volume loop. We are trying to track the cardiac wall over a full contraction and a full relaxation cycle. So what they do is they take this and they track the circumferential, sorry, they track the strain over a full cardiac cycle at 5% increments. They then go back and measure the exact same frame and measure the volume. So what do you get? You get these kind of curves. So I'll just try and explain this. So we'll start up here. So this is the start of contraction. You can see volume drops and strain decreases as it contracts. And then we can see the opposite when it relaxes. So what we're trying to do basically here is marry the function and the volume together. So we've got a functional volume changes. So we've seen this interaction. And what we see, we can do this for the right side of the heart and the left side of the heart. And what happens following the marathon is we get a rightward shift in the right ventricle and a leftward shift in the left ventricle. And what they're suggesting that this might mean is that in the right ventricle, the dysfunction is due to overfilling. And in the left ventricle, the dysfunction is due to underfilling. So we can't really compare this data to much at the moment because there's no comparative data, but it's something that the group's developing and trying to understand the mechanics of what's happening to the heart following this ultra-endurance exercise. So what does that all mean? Well, we see we're getting this fatigue in the heart following endurance exercise, but does it matter? Is it important? Well, let's track the changes. And here's the kind of key thing. If you come back 1 to 2 days later, function's normal again, which is why it's got this title, exercise-induced cardiac fatigue, because it suggests that it's a transient change and that the heart will recover after a few days. And in the majority of people, we do see that it's back to normal again. So maybe it's not that clinically important, but it is important in terms of understanding physiological adaptations. So I've touched on the function. So you remember I showed you the creatine kinase data. Let's have a look at some of the markers of myocardial damage. So since the creatine kinase days, the techniques have sort of changed and moved on quite a bit. So what we look at now is something called troponin. So this is the second generation cardiac troponin. Because the problem we had with the creatine kinase and some of the early generations of the troponin is that some of this is released from skeletal muscle. So you were getting false positive releases from muscle. However, the techniques now are much more specific, and they are specific only to the cardiac isoforms. So this is troponin T after a marathon. So we have 72 marathon runners. The key thing is before the race, none of them had any evidence of troponin T in the blood. However, post-race, It's up to nearly 80% had some. I mean, it's a very low level, but it's there. And some are getting to the points where you might start to think, if you were a clinician, that something adverse has happened to the heart. If you walked in, having not run a marathon, to a hospital with that, they would suspect maybe you've had an MI. So that's where the issue comes. Now, that's just an example. If we then look, there's now an awful lot of data on troponin post-endurance events. And remember, again, I'm talking marathon plus really here. So here we can see the data from a whole different plethora of studies with different techniques, cycling and running and triathlon. And basically, if you do a meta-analysis on this, essentially see about half the individuals will have an elevated troponin post-race. But really, if we're looking at the data, what you can see is a massive amount of variability. And I should point out, that's the same with the cardiac function data as well. Although we've generally seen a drop in most people post-race, there's a very wide range of data. So you will get probably the majority having some sort of depressed function, but you will have some who are completely normal or even improved post-race. So it's something to be aware of, that when we're looking at mean data, we might be hiding the individual responses. So this obviously brought up the question, okay, we've seen this massive variability, but is that just because we're taking one measurement post-race? So that led on to the study. This is Natalie Middleton's PhD with Rob Shave and Greg Whyte and Keith George. And what they did is they tracked troponin during and following a race at multiple time points. So here's the individual data that we see now. So this is cardiac troponin T. Here we've got solid lines during the race and post the race. So everybody has an elevation in troponin T. If we took that one post-race measurement, I think there's only one there who's got an elevated troponin. But over time, we see this biphasic response in all the individuals. So troponin is getting released by pretty much everybody during prolonged exercise. But it's worth knowing that this is a very transient, very low levels. So it's probably physiological and not pathological. So I'm not going to go into too much depth about the mechanisms, but I think essentially the thinking at the moment is that it's not representative of damage to the myocytes or to the myosin itself. What we do have is we have some free troponin T and I in the cytosolic component of the cells, and what's happening is we're somehow making this membrane more permeable, a little bit more leaky. So we're getting release of this cytosolic component out of the membrane into the circulation where we're detecting it. So rather than damage per se, we're just affecting the cell wall a little bit. And I think that's the current thinking of typically what's happening in most individuals when we're seeing this low elevated troponin. So we've talked about how we've got this change in function. We've got this depressed left and right ventricular function. We've got this marker of damage. Are the two linked? You know, is one causing the other, or are we getting some sort of epiphenomenon? But essentially, I think the argument is, certainly from the left side of the heart, there's no association at all. So again, that's kind of arguing that it's probably not damage that's happening to the heart that's then causing this fatigue. They're two sort of separate mechanisms, certainly from the left side of the heart anyway. And the key thing for both the cardiac function and for the troponin is we see a return to normal within a couple of days. So the reason the troponin data is a little bit interesting, though, and this is certainly something that Greg talks a lot about, is we are seeing that elevated troponin. Sometimes it's quite high in some of these athletes. And if they collapse post-race with the shortness of breath and elevated troponin, it's basically everything a clinician would suggest, that something awful is happening to them and that they should have some really extensive investigations. They often get told to detrain for 6 weeks. So I think it's something that we need to, or the clinicians need to be aware of, and Greg's written some reviews and some sort of time courses of what we should do, or what clinicians should do, if they see someone with an elevated troponin post-race, that it's not the same as seeing an elevated troponin in a non-active person or someone who's just gone for a jog. It's something to be aware of, that this troponin might just be a normal physiological response as opposed to evidence of an acute myocardial event. So, touched on the function, I've talked about the damage. I'm going to do very little bit now really on the conductors, mainly because there's very little data out there. I think there's fewer than half a dozen studies that have examined the electrical conductance of the heart pre and post ultra-endurance events. But what have they found? So essentially, I think the main finding is that we see changes in evidence of repolarization. So But what you can see here, I mean, for example, this is pre and post a race, and in the V3, for example, you can see an a higher T wave and an elevated take off the T wave, which again, a clinician would take as markers of myocardial infarction. So there's some evidence that there are a few changes, and this is unpublished work from Rachel Lord that suggests that it's, like I said, this repolarization that seems to be changing the most. But it's really limited data, and it's all pre and post. So I think in an ideal world, you'd want a 12-lead ECG through a race. Obviously, that's not possible. So the best way to do it instead is what they've just done a pilot study in a handful of studies, and they've got this Zio patch, which is kind of the equivalent of a 3-lead ECG, and they're measuring them during this prolonged Western States run. And what do they find? Well, very little, which is great news, really. They saw practically no ectopics and no evidence of arrhythmias. So I think from the electrical conductance point of view, there's limited data that there are changes. And if there are changes, it seems to be repolarization. But what does that mean? I've shown the cardiac fatigue. I've shown markers of, if not damage, something happening to the myocytes. But does that actually mean anything in terms of our clinical outcomes? Are we putting ourselves at risk by doing these ultra-endurance events? So here's our relative risk. This is from compared to sitting down and doing nothing. And we know that there's an elevated risk of an acute myocardial infarction during exercise. And that's across the board. It's the exercise paradox. We know that exercise training improves our function, but when you're doing the exercise per se, you're at a slight increased risk. We know that if you only do a little bit of exercise per week, when you're doing the exercise, it increases a lot more, but if you're regularly active when we're doing exercise, yes, there's a very small increase, but it's not that high. But what about doing ultra-endurance events? Well, to be honest, the data is not really out there, but I think what we can say is we're not getting a mass exodus of people from the end of these endurance events going into hospital with acute events. So I think the evidence is not suggesting really that these ultra-endurance events are massively increasing our risk of an acute myocardial infarction. Maybe there's a transient increase in some people, but it's not a huge event. It's not enough to tell people to go out, stop training, and run in these races. So what I've basically done so far is I've just touched on all this acute response. And we've seen that it's transient and that it recovers. But what are the long-term consequences of doing these events? These guys who do these races year in, year out. So I'm going to start off with the slightly more negative data, so to speak, of changes that happen. So this is from Matt Wilson and Greg Whyte, and this is an MRI of a regular ultra-endurance athlete. And these little areas here on the MRI, these white suggestions, they are suggesting this is area of fibrosis. So in these lifelong ultra-marathon runners, maybe we're getting some fibrosis as a result of doing these events. And obviously that has huge implications for potential arrhythmias. So most of the evidence, the mechanistic evidence for this comes from animal work, and what they're suggesting happens, for example, so this is Chen's work, and they forced rats to swim for a really long time with an increased stress or 8% increase in body mass. And what they find is some histological evidence of an inflammatory response, essentially. So we're getting this infiltration into the myocytes of these inflammatory influences, and it suggests that this may then trigger the regeneration of these myocytes to become fibrotic. So further evidence, this is these late GAD scans, again from a lifelong endurance runner. And again, these little white areas are suggestive that we are seeing some kind of damage or some kind of fibrosis. So that's kind of painting a little bit of a negative picture, but the truth is this is probably very minimal in very few people, and we don't know the consequences of it. We don't know if this is then going to trigger a fatal arrhythmia. So it's still really early data, this, and they're still trying to work out if it is fibrosis and then what effect is this happening on the athlete's sort of conduction. So I think there's two thoughts that you can go with this exercise-induced cardiac fatigue and how the heart adapts to it. And we've basically got the physiological adaptation and the pathological adaptation. So this is basically the hormesis argument, that to adapt, certainly in physiology, we need some sort of stress of what can be quite toxic at high levels, but if you give it at low levels, then the body will adapt. In the same way we see with skeletal muscle. If you stress the skeletal muscle, it looks very damaged, but then it hypertrophies in response to that. So maybe this is the same thing that's happening with the heart. Maybe what we're seeing is this repair is resulting in this hypertrophy, and then the heart is adapting by becoming bigger. The flip side of that is maybe we're not getting this adequate recovery, and instead of hypertrophying, we're getting scarring, which is leading to fibrotic replacement, and then that could potentially trigger an arrhythmia. So there are the two arguments of what could be happening, the physiological and the pathological. And if we were looking at that from a diagram point of view, and this is what they're hypothesizing, is that in some people, if it's like a minor damage, I'm a little bit wary saying damage, but some stress or some insult to the heart, it drops, but then it supercompensates and recovers, and eventually that leads to a normal physiological adaptation and normal function. However, on the flip side, if we're getting a much bigger stress and inadequate recovery time, we could potentially be seeing this greater damage, which may lead to the more negative adaptations in the heart. So that's the two hypotheses of what could be happening. So, we do know that we see depressed right ventricular and left ventricular function certainly right ventricular function in athletes. This is at rest. And maybe this is Lagersche's work, some evidence of right ventricular cardiomyopathy. The studies that I just showed you showed that lifelong athletes might have fibrosis. It is known that athletes do tend to see more arrhythmias, but I think this is the caveat. I think the take-home message from this is that prolonged exercise training is still good for us. So this is a study that did marathon training in middle-aged men. So basically, they measured the function before and after an eight-week training program. And basically, most of the adaptations we see are beneficial. So VO2 peak goes up, body mass has positive changes, left ventricular diastolic function improves. And all these markers, these cholesterols, these other indices of future risk are all improved. So I don't want the story to be here, prolonged exercise is bad for you. But the best way to do this is to let's have a look at the function of these elite athletes who do this training day in and day out. So this is data again from Victor Atuma. He just did his PhD with Dave Oxburgh and Keith, and it's Dave Oxburgh's data as well. So they've got elite athletes. So let's have a look at the heart of these elite athletes and see how it's different from the normal population. So this is the left ventricle. This dot line here is the cutoff line from the American Society of Echocardiography. Anything above this dotted line is normally considered pathological hypertrophy. So we are seeing really big left ventricles, so a big mass, a big end diastolic volume. But let's look at the function. And the truth is the function of this is normal. So yes, these guys have big hearts, they have big left ventricles, but they're still functioning very well. They can still contract and they can still relax. And that's the key difference between a physiological and a pathological hypertrophy. In the physiological, it still functions very well. What about the right side of the heart? Well, again, it's pretty similar. We've seen an awful lot of athletes with large right ventricles, the inflow and the outflow. But when we check the function, so here's the E prime, so diastolic function and systolic function are all normal. So this is in endurance and resistance training compared to control, and there's practically no difference. So they're big, but they work well. And likewise, just to say the same again for the atria, they have really big atria, but the function is normal. So I think the message from that then is that, yes, we are getting adaptations as you would expect in the heart to this prolonged exercise training, but the heart still functions well. What about the ECG? So we do see abnormal ECGs in a lot of athletes. And I think a lot of that is because the ECG is quite a basic test, and it's not that sensitive. So if we look at these athletes, and yes, they've got this abnormal ECG, but if you do further screening, for example, echocardiography, then we see that the function is normal. So it's just something to be aware of, like the troponins, with the abnormal ECG, what is a normal and what is an abnormal ECG? And I think the cutoffs for a lot of this came from young, like under 35-year-old individuals. So maybe it's something that has to be taken into account, you know, the age and the training status of these guys. And is it pathological or is it physiological adaptations? So that's my kind of brief overview of the exercise-induced cardiac fatigue story. We do know that this endurance exercise, it is a massive strain or stress to the body. It's highly competitive. They're very motivated. They will push themselves beyond, you know, what the average person will do. So it is a very big strain on the heart. We know we get environmental challenges that come along with it as well that might influence our findings. And we do get these transient acute changes where function in the left and right ventricle will drop, biomarkers of damage will go up. Maybe there's some evidence of ECG, but there's further data needed for that. But in the long-term point of view, normally it's a physiological adaptation, with the caveat that there will be some individuals that maybe we're seeing this maladaptation, this pathological adaptation that may trigger this pathological cascade. And I'd just like to finish off. This is our Tom Riley building at Liverpool John Moores. Tom Riley is one of the founders of ECSS. And I'd just like to thank Keith and Greg for dropping me in it. But I hope you enjoyed the talk. Thanks very much.